Marys.
Mm-hmm.
And that means war.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're telling us he's a sin hurting people through attacks on life. But in war, it's about killing the enemy.
Let me ask you, where did the boundaries come from? Did they come from God or they came from people?
Even God also had his boundaries.
No, first answer my question.
Because if you read the Bible,
he had he had the word Israel out of others. But you know, I'm sorry to say this, if you read the whole of the Bible, especially the Old Testament, without the eyes of society, you miss the point.
I don't know.
I didn't explain what I mean. And by referring to the Bible itself. When the Bible speaks of the fall of Adam and Eve, and also speaks about Abel and Cain, that is Genesis chapter 3 and chapter 4. So when you read chapter 4, the Bible, the world had a population of four. It was Adam, Eve, Cain, and Abel. Cain killed his brother Abel, so the population of the world remained three people. And God condemns Cain. He punishes him by putting a mark on him so that people may not kill him. So people that were supposed to kill him, ideally were only two, his mother and father. Did they not know him?
They did.
So why would God have to put a mark on his face so that people may not kill him? Moses?
I'm still trying to get my bearing.
So the Old Testament is, say, it's a social book. It's a book written by an ethnic group of people. Israelites and the group of people, and trying to look at all their way with other neighbors. The way Cain represents the Canaanite community and Abel represents the Israelite community. So we say that the Bible allows it because if you read the Bible literally, that's what it means. But really, the Bible is. The database is a social book which is written by a group of people that has been fighting wars and whatever against other neighbors. Maybe I'm taking you another time of discussing the Bible. So what I want to bring here is that ideally God does not want people to kill each other, whether in wars or in whatever. But the Old Testament is a testament of wars and killings and revenge and other things.
Exactly.
But ideally, the God of the New Testament does not allow this. And for me, the God that I serve is the God of the New Testament. Not the one of the Old Testament who has boundaries and whatever. But I serve the God of the universe, the God of everyone, and the God who wants people to live in freedom and whatever.
But Professor?
Yes, please.
Mr. Eddie has asked a question before we break off.
Yes.
But, I've not got a good answer, like, if I'm at home.
Okay, respond.
If I'm at home.
Yes.
In my house at night, an enemy has come, maybe he's a thief, he has a gun, and I've seen him first. What should I do? Is it okay I can kill him?
There is a very big ethics, the ethics of war, and justice in war, and justice of war. Ethics of war, the justice of war, and the justice in war. One, you are allowed to use, you are legitimately allowed to use force and even kill. That is only when you were attacked and you have no option of saving that life. People like killing you and Eliezer.
They are sadness.
So when you are seriously attacked, and the only option is to eliminate this other person, it is ethically allowed. But that is when other options are considered to have failed. Okay, can we go ahead?
Yes.
We're looking at the structure of sin. The structure of sin, which stands for the personal sins. I don't know that anybody is teaching some lessons on this. When we create policies, create structures that don't allow people's freedoms.
Yes. I think you need to mute Judith.
Judith is the one who's making noise, by the way.
Mute her first. I think she's making up something.
Yeah, she was
making up. I'm sorry if you don't mute you.
So what I'm saying is that when we make policies that create serious problems and cramp on people's justices and whatever, the stem of it is from personal sin. What me as a person want, and then that is from the collective choices of many, and is sustained by selfishness. So the person gets other people, gets others, they become many, they make choices, and the choices that are very selfish, it becomes a barrier to the common good. And when you make that policy, the common good is never served and affects patterns of relationships. And these are things that we are always told to run away from. If we have to make policies, we have to make structures that are open for everyone so that we serve the common good. I just wanted to go into because this you allow me to into this ethical leadership. I understand you as people who are already a working class. We are all mature people. We work with others. We work for others. We work for institutions. And whatever we do in one way or the other affects us and affects others. So somebody who is to be an ethical person has to show what we are calling the ethical leadership. The ethical leadership. And what does this mean, or what does this involve? There are some questions that we need to first pose to ourselves. And these important questions that I call them important, that I call them, these questions that I call important are very necessary for us to observe on them. One, what moral theory applies or informs the leader best on how to decide or act? So we have been leaders in one way or the other, either a leader of a class, a leader of a club, a leader of whatever. What moral theory applies or informs us whenever we are making choices or whenever we are acting? The second one, what core values are involved in the situation of a leader making it affect other people? We have some values when we are making choices when we are making plans, when we are making I don't know what, and things that affect people that are with us, under us, or we serve. The third, do the people, the circumstances and culture have any importance in making my choice? When I am leading a community, let me call it a university, let me call it a parliament, let me call it a club of the rich or the poor. Do those people that I'm leading and what we are passing through, all the culture, that do they have any importance in what I do or what when I'm making some choices? And if they do, what importance do they have? So these are the questions that a leader must question himself. And before we do that, we have to ask our questions, what is ethical leadership? And this is a leadership that involves both acting and leading ethically over time and all the time. So to act, to lead in ethical way all the time, without ceasing. And this is very important for everyone. This is very important for everyone. So we are talking about choices. The first thing, the question we are asking ourselves, really majorly about choices. Sorry. I don't know what. Ethical choices are generally not between issues of good and evil, but rather between two goods, such as truth and loyalty, that is failing to disclose or address improper conduct because of fear of the boss, or striking to the truth for the truth's sake. We know that this is the over time. I don't know who's making some noise, no?
It's Joseph.
This is the problem of our time. One is to be royal over and above the truth. To be royal over and above the truth. Can I get an example in our current society where we have people who are royal, who are royal to the royalties, the bosses, rather than the truth? Examples, please.
People who are loyal to the boss, not the truth.
Yes. Or situations where we find people seem to be loyal to the boss. The boss could be a system, could be a person, could be a party, could be whatever. And they put aside the truth.
But that is our ministers in Uganda right now. The regime is failing to do what it's supposed to do, but every day they are praising it. But inside themselves, they know things are not the way they are supposed to be.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think even our justice, I think in addition to what Bruce is saying, our justice system is equally in a situation like that, especially judges who are appointed by the president, and you find when they're arbitrating cases where perhaps the president is in a way involved in some unbecoming dealings or conducts, the case is normally not handled with the diligence it deserves if, for example, it was an ordinary person involved in that matter. Mm.
Remember,
yes, Professor.
Yes, please, can you?
Well, to add on top of what Judith has just said and Ruth, in fact, these situations are very common in Africa. It's not only in Uganda, it is Africa as a whole. Of course, in every country or in every institution, there are always guideline where every employee is supposed to follow. But in our situation as Africans, you find leaders influencing their subjects, and everything is done according to their will. We only see this in West where institutions are independent from leaders. But in Africa, institutions always favor leaders, or leaders influence everyone there, and everything is done according to what they want. In other words, they coerce their followers, and they have them, you know, do things in the way that they want things to be. So it is not only in Uganda. It is in Africa as a whole.
Okay, thank you very much, everyone. So remember, when we were beginning our course, we said that ethics is to choose between what is good and what is evil, what is bad and what is whatever. But we find that there is a level that it goes a level a little bit higher. Between choice between truth and loyalty. So truth and loyalty is what we see around. But when the MPs go to, whether it is in Changwanzi or anywhere, they know what is good for Uganda, they know what is true for Uganda, they turn around and they want to become royal under to their monies or to their president, or I don't know to what. This is not leading ethically. The second one is what we call the individual against community. Individual against community. Private or personal benefits and the benefits of the society, current and the future. So failure to address, let me first clear my table properly so that you can see what I'm talking about. So failure to address yourself against the community, and you think about yourself, your personal benefits, well, become selfish, you become unconcerned about society, you become unconcerned about the future and the present situation which people are living in, that is again another choice that a leader must always strive to address.
Professor, just a small one.
Yes, please.
I would seek clarification or clarity.
Yes.
Or better yet, an example of individual versus community, because the introduction says there is a contention between choice of two goods. I would seek an example of two goods in the paradigm of individual and community.
Can I throw it back to the class?
Pardon?
He's asking that he wants to see where the choice, the ethical choice, should also be between the individual and the community. We gave the example of truth against loyalty. Can we get an example of truth against community?
Maybe, Professor, if I may attempt,
yes,
with your permission.
Please.
For instance, when we were handling the land amendment bill, the constitutional amendment bill,
yes,
the members of parliament were torn in between whether you want individual interest, and individual interest in this case means that you remain in good books with your relevant party.
Mm-hmm.
However, the community where you have gone to consult are telling you something different.
Mm-hmm.
And they are the ones who voted you into power.
Mm-hmm.
You ought to have loyalty with them.
Mm-hmm.
And at the same time also have loyalty with your party.
Mm-hmm.
So you are torn in between. What do you take? Do you decide to be loyal with your community, then you will be called a rebel? Or you come and you secure your interests with the party, you come and vote against what the community told you, so that you remain in good books with your party, because you know in the future you will need their party card. So that is where I can come up with the a difference.
Yeah, yes. I think I don't know that you have understood.
Somehow, maybe, but I am seeing a contention between community, individual community. The two communities being the political party and the people.
No, there are many levels where you can talk about the individual. It could be a person himself, who decides to take things by himself. I give an example. I have a friend of mine, a family friend, used to be a family friend, but to do otherwise. These people, the person I'm talking about was a commissioner in the Ministry of Health. And he was a medical doctor. He is a medical doctor. I know his background. Entered into the ministry when he was a poor person like anybody. Down the line, within about 3 years, he had built a very powerful house. Very powerful house. Was having a very powerful presence, very living powerful life. I mean, very rich life. His children, one of the kids was studying in one school in Kampala, national school in Kampala. They are paying $5 million. Batam. And where the person got this money from was not from his salary, but definitely was getting money that was meant to cure people's illnesses and sicknesses in hospitals. So he was turning the private community into a private personal benefit. And that is what we're talking about here. That somebody who makes a choice, either you act selfishly, or you benefit the society. And here we are saying whether it's a certain of today or a sort of tomorrow. The whites, the people in the West, normally think about the future. Africans never think about the future. We think about today and tomorrow. But we never think about people will have after us 100 years to come. And when we have to make policies that are very serious policies that are ethical, is to think to run away from individual benefits, but into the communal welfare. Yes, are we together?
Somehow I'm getting, because the introduction had the part saying generally not between issues of good and evil, and I was concentrating on the contention between good and bad.
No, the past person is, the introduction is very good, because it talks about that above ethical choices between good and evil, we have to also put there two other goods or two things. And we divide them into three areas: truth, loyalty, individual, community. And now I'm talking about short term against long term. So short term versus long term. Expediency is the opposite of ethics. But see what has been happening in alien policies that affect the public. So I'm talking about, what am I talking about here is, so we know that Uganda is here, has been here and will be here longer than everybody else. I could be here for only 8 years if God is very willing to take me to this time. Or 70, I don't know how long or when I will die, but we know that the country will remain. So here we make policies that are really short term. We don't think about the future. People are only thinking about the time of NRM and M7. But NRM is not going to rule this country forever. These things we are the people are creating these policies that are being created by parliament, by different parties. They are short-lived, they are short-term, and they don't think about the long-term effects that we have on the public, and perhaps what will come tomorrow. There is a precedence that you are setting across. Uganda has never had a change of presidency, for example. And instead of, let us experiment with it, we are perpetuating, somehow perpetuating leaders either being pushed out or whatever. So this is an area that I'm also trying to think about. So how do we make policies? How do we make choices as leaders? Are we concentrating on short term, or we are now also trying to concentrate on long term areas where we can talk with, where we can engage with other people? Any question, Eddie?
Yeah, I'm okay.
They're okay. Ethics in a state government.
Hold on a bit.
Okay, please, Eliezer.
Previous slide, when you use the word expedience, for me, it refers to profit. Does that mean if you're acting ethically, you should not think about profit?
You have muted yourself.
No, I am saying.
Yes.
Can everyone hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay. Professors use the word expediency as the opposite of ethics. And to me, the synonym of expediency is profit. Does that mean if you're going to act in an ethical manner, you should forget about profit and being rich?
I think, Eliezer, you need to look at the context in which this sentence is written. So if you concentrate on enriching yourself when other people are being put into abject poverty, I'm not saying that being rich is bad, but if your riches are already to pull down others, it becomes an evil.
It's okay.
Professor, please.
Please, Eddie.
If you met Jim Wales, what would you tell him?
First, tell me what you would tell him yourself.
To bring back Gavi funds.
He's the biggest, he's among the biggest thieves we have had in the country. There is a question that there is something that was happening in Kenya recently. The most corrupt people, the Kenyan country is thinking about is the deputy president. And
Richard.
And he has been giving money to churches. And people were saying that the bishops should not be accepting his money because they know where the money comes from. What do you think about that? These people, whenever they come home for Christmas, we give them special seats. We allow them to speak. They give some money, some benefit, some whatever. Jim was used to give iron sheets for churches, for building churches and whatever, and people will grab hands. We don't know where the money comes from. So can we have some discussion about this? What should be the right way into which community, into which a country, into which a community can approach these kind of personalities?
Sir, I want to disagree with you.
Mm-hmm.
First of all,
We are not hearing you very well. I don't know what's happening.
saying,
yes,
incorrupt. I'm saying it is unfair to compare Ruto to name Ruto as the most corrupt person in Kenya when there is Uhuru who is continuing where his father stopped.
Okay, that one I can say okay.
Professor.
Yes, please.
I want to disagree with Eddie. I think the issue is not the comparison between Uhuru and Ruto.
Mm-hmm.
As long as they are all corrupt.
It's bad.
The issue
true.
Is that, yes, this is bad. Whether you take a little or you take a big. The issue is this issue of charges, where they go and give them special recognitions and at some point they even pray for them. I'm not talking about Kenya in this case alone, but it also happened in my own community. We have people who are known for corruption, who build bigger houses, and when they go to church, even church leaders pray for them. When they know that these people are corrupt. So to me, these church leaders are not serious. They are supposed to condemn them. You are not supposed to take those whatever they offer to church. Yes.
Allow me
because
the biblical manner. Can allow me. I would love to disagree with him in a biblical manner.
We are not hearing you very well.
I am saying I would love to disagree with Joseph in a biblical manner.
Yes.
According to the
what does the Bible say?
Yes, in Genesis, when Cain and Abel went to offer, God did not reject Cain's offering. He just rejected the man, not the offering. Not giving back his offering. He just rejected the man.
he took the thing, but rejected the man.
Yeah, he took the offering and rejected the man.
Professor,
and one thing we need to understand church politics. The church also looks at this as a way of benefiting, because
if the church is to benefit or no,
yeah,
or anybody, every time I meet that friend of money that I talked about, every time I hear about where's offering, yes, let's listen. Every time I meet that friend of mine I'm talking about, every time I pass by the house of Jim Wesley and his empire, I only see tombs of children who died of malaria. I only see tombs of children who died because of lack of immunization. I see tombs of women who died in labor. So why should a community knowing that...
Which lenses are you using?
I'm using the lenses to know that they stole drugs that could have hit them.
Professor.
Yes.
Professor.
Using the example of Jim, it's not that I associate myself with these actions. Nonetheless, I've shared with the class before, and I've shared again the link on our WhatsApp. During your free time, you can read about that Greek man who was a thief, a perennial thief. But what motivated him to steal is because he was seeing rich people were getting very rich and the poor people are suffering more. And because he had grown up poor, he knew the excitement he had when he had his first shoe. So what he used to do, he used to go and rob banks, get the money, and he distributes it to the poor. And to him, that was resource redistribution. And each time the police used to come to look for him, even the local people would protect him. But he was a thief. So to me, here, the intention matters. So I do not condone.
What about the act?
Yes, you see now, the act of stealing is not good. But if you're doing something for the greater good. Remember, you told us about what is the end result. So if the intention, the ultimate intention is to benefit the vulnerable, you've even been talking about preferential option for the poor and the vulnerable. You do it.
Professor, I think there are a lot of ethical dilemmas. What Moses is saying is similar to what happened in Mexico a few years ago. I think most of the people must have heard of this guy called El Chapo or something. He was a drug lord. Yes. When this guy was arrested and detained, people went on demonstration in Mexico, pressuring those who arrested him because we are told this guy could pay so many students in school. And he's a drug lord.
So in other words, here
Moses is using utilitarianism. He's looking at the consequences of maybe a certain act. Like if you steal, you go and help people somewhere. To me, it is not ethical. Because we must condemn it right from down there. How you come to get this wealth? Because the objective of ethics here is to contain societies to exhibit a certain level of morality. So if we encourage people to steal and crack down, helping, and then we may all be steal, which have encouraged everyone to try and steal. So I think others may contribute, but to me, it's not right.
I'm trying to get that article that he's referring to, but I think it's not proper. Because if we allow everybody now to go and rob banks so that you can see things.
No, Professor, I only shared for argument's sake, but I do not subscribe to that school.
If you may, I beg you, subscribe to such.
Okay. I was like, it's very open, I don't know why. But I wanted to share it with everyone. Okay. Are you still with me or no? Yeah. No. Okay. Can we continue?
Yes, sir.
So we had started ethics in state government. And we're saying that the policies